What are all of these shader nodes for? So many Blender learners want to end their confusion with shader nodes. So first, I want to teach you everything I've learned about shader nodes over the past 8 years of doing Blender, and which ones you need to use for your projects.
So take a look at these nodes, let's go ahead and change to the shader editor. So I'm just going to left click and drag up my timeline here, and then I'm just going to left click the clock and change to shader editor. Then of course we need an object to actually apply our shaders to. So let's press Shift A, and then under mesh I'll choose cube. Then I'm going to change this from line style here to object, and I'll just press this plus new button to add a new material. Material is what all of our shader nodes are stored inside of. You'll see that by default we get two nodes, a principal BSDF and a material output. This principal BSDF is actually one of our shader nodes, and this material output just decides what gets outputted onto our object. But right now we can't see anything. Notice how if I change my base color, for example, to red, by left clicking it and then changing it to this red color, we can't see anything in the viewport. So we need to go into material preview. So I'll just come up to the top here and I'll just left click this button here. But for some reason our object is black. In Blender 4.2, this just seems to happen. So we need to enable a couple of settings to fix it. So I'm going to change my render engine here from cycles to EV. If you're familiar with render engines, you might be wondering why we're doing this, but it's essentially because this material preview mode here uses the EV render engine. Then I can open up ray tracing, left click this checkbox to enable it, and turn my max roughness to 1. Awesome, now it should be working fine. You'll also notice if I unplug the surface here by just left clicking and dragging this notch here, you can see we have nothing in our scene because we don't have anything going into the surface. To fix that, we just take this green dot here and plug it into the surface socket. On all of our shader nodes, this green socket is our output, so you can think of it as taking all of the information calculated in this box here and taking it out and then plugging it into this material output to give us our result. If I press Shift A, you can see I've got a menu here which allows me to add a bunch of different nodes. If we come to shader, here we can see all of the shader nodes. For example, we have diffuse BSDF, which we'll be talking about in the next video. If I press Shift A again and come to shader, you can see I've also got glass BSDF, I can press Shift A again and under shader. We've also got principal BSDF, which is just a copy of this default one here. And as I was mentioning, you can see how all of these have this green output at the end, which is a great way of recognizing them as a shader. They will also have this green banner on top, which other nodes won't have. We'll talk more about the different parameters in the series, but I'll cover some of the basics. First of all, most of these nodes will have some form of color input. This allows us to left click this box and change the color here. I'll plug this one in just to show. But color isn't limited to just this box here. You can also plug in color from other sources, such as from a texture, for example. So if I press Shift A and then come to the texture, you can see I've got a bunch of options here for textures. And if I choose noise texture, for example, and plug the color into the color, you can see that generated noise texture here is now being used as the color input for our shader. You also notice that we can take this color and we can plug it straight into the surface. And you can see this looks quite noticeably different from when it's plugged into the shader first. This is because there's no lighting information being calculated here, it's just a flat color. Whereas when we plug it into the shader first, and then plug the shader into the surface, you can now think of this as an object which has this color, but then it has lighting information and other calculations applied to it before being shown to us with this material output node. So I like to think of shaders as a way of taking in inputs and then performing some calculations and then giving us a shaded output. If you're wondering where all this lighting information from our scene is coming from, this is because the material preview uses a basic HDRI, which is like a photo of a room or an environment, which is then used as a light source. So that's why we do have some shading here. But you'll notice, for example, if I go into this render preview mode, things here look a little bit different, as our render preview will be using our world properties for lighting, as well as any light objects you add to your scene. For example, by pressing Shift A and then coming to light, then maybe I could press G and X. And if I move to the right here, you can see that that's creating a lighting effect on our cube. You also notice how the world properties are affected here, because if I come to this world properties option here, you can see we've got a color option and a strength. This color option is actually how we can add our own HDRIs, but that's a little bit out of the scope of this video. But I could also change the color of this, and you can see how that would influence our object in our scene. And you can also change the strength, so I can make this brighter by increasing the strength. I could turn this off completely by turning it to 0. Now you can see our object is only being affected by the lighting of this point light. I'll come back to material preview just now, and you'll notice how our point light doesn't affect our cube in this material preview, as material preview just uses its own lighting. Next up we have normal. This allows us to use special nodes, such as a bump node or a normal map node, in order to add some extra detail to our objects by editing the normals on a pixel level to create some really cool results. For example, you can notice I can plug this factor into the color, for example. You'll notice that this noise texture just has a simple black and white noisy version. And we can actually use this with a bump node in order to create some cool bumpy detail. I'll press Shift A and then under vector, I'll add bump. You can see this node is purple and it also has an output called normal, which would work well for plugging into this normal socket here. I'll plug my noise texture factor into the height, and then plug my normal into the normal. I also unplug my color here. You can see this has created a cool bumpy effect, but there's not actually any modeling happening here. This is just manipulation of each of these faces. This bump node is really cool because, of course, you can do things like alter the strength to make this effect stronger or weaker, and it gives us a lot of options. When I press Shift A and come to shader, you'll see that we have a bunch of different shader nodes, and all of these will have slightly different functions, which I'll be going more into depth with in this series. But some examples we have would include glass shaders, metal shaders, light shaders, transparent shaders, and even some cool shading effects like anisotropic. In the next video in this series, I'm going to be talking a little bit about the diffuse BSDF, so if you don't want to miss that, make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell if you want to be notified for that. Also, if you're serious about leveling up your Blender skills faster, so you can master shader nodes and other 3D skills, make sure to click the first link in the description. Apart from that though, I'd like to thank you so much for watching this tutorial, and I'll see you for the next installment in the series. Take care!